updates. One from Colonel Hallberg and his staff are here, along with Kyle Spencer, our acting chief resilience officer, to talk through where we are in phase one of the coastal storm risk management project. This is a big step forward this evening, a big public step forward this evening. We're going to see the full project and how long it's going to take us to get through it. We all are all familiar with some of the costs, but we'll go through that a little bit as well. We also have Susan Perry here. Dr. Perry's got an update on St. Paul's with our housing, our People First Housing Plan initiative, as well as some of the other updates to the new construction that's starting. It's been a while since we've had a briefing, though SPAC has continued meeting throughout, but I thought it'd be important for us to have that update this evening. I wanted to start this evening, though, with something that's been on Council's mind. We were tasked several months ago, I think, Councilman Riddick, Councilwoman McClellan, and some others, Councilwoman Royster, were a little concerned about putting the temporary location for the boxing center in Ingleside. It's a pretty small rec center. That was going to consume the entire rec center with no hope of ever sort of reopening Ingleside for anything other than the boxing program. We went back at it, have worked on a few things since then, and we believe we have a great opportunity this evening that Daryl Crittenden is here to talk through a temporary location that I think really achieves two of our goals. Number one is getting the boxing program back open and operational quickly and in a good spot, and then also reopening one of our currently closed facilities for open rec as well. And so with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Daryl. I don't wanna steal all of his thunder. I will let Daryl share some of the good news of what he's got for you all this evening. Thanks for being here, Daryl.
No problem, sir.
You okay then?
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, council members,
city manager Filer. Parks and Recreation is very pleased this afternoon to announce, after a two-year hiatus, the Team Norfolk program will start back, and it'll be in the Park Place Multi-Service Center. We will kick off the boxing operations on June 1. We'll have a soft opening right around 4 o'clock, and we'll have operating hours of Monday through Friday from 12 to 8 p.m., on Saturdays from 10 to 2. And the reason why, the open recreation portion of our program will be around 12 to 4. Then we have beginning boxing classes from 4 to 5:30. Then Team Norfolk Boxing comes in from 5:30 to 8. On Saturday mornings, as well as from 12 to 4, we'll have instructional classes, anywhere from self-defense classes. We'll have warrior fitness classes, low impact aerobics. It'll be a full gamut of instructional classes as well at this site. We're looking forward to it. Our coaches can't wait to get started. The Davis brothers will be popping in to make sure the program's going full speed. So we're very excited about this opportunity and this temporary location. And
I definitely want to thank Daryl and his staff. I think one of the things we heard pretty loud and clear from council was, can we find a way to get this thing going before school gets out? This, I think, is that route. This is about our only option at this point to get it by June 1st. The great thing about this as well, and I didn't want to steal the thunder on the location, Park Place is currently a shuttered facility. We did not have the staffing ability to open Park Place for open rec and do the boxing program somewhere else. So the beauty of doing it in Park Place now, right there in a, what I think is a really well-located facility, we can do both boxing and open rec. So this not only gets our boxing program going again, this gets the Park Place Rec Center reopened. So I think it really is good news. We're happy to take any questions you have. I do have something, and I'll send this out to council. I had Civic Lab just run a little bit of the demographic information in the mile radius and 2 mile radius around Park Place. I know there's been a lot of conversation about making sure, even for the temporary location, making sure that we had it somewhere where there were a lot of kids, right? It was something that where it was really accessible to the broader community. And I can tell you from here, for the population aged 0 to 17 in a 2-mile radius of this facility, there are 11,000 children in that radius. So that's pretty good. That's going to hit a lot of potential kids for this program. So, Daryl, I can't thank you enough for the work your folks have done. Obviously, when we say temporary, we do intend this to be temporary. This is probably a year to a year and a half to 2 years. We're going to begin immediately the process and have already begun the process of trying to identify the permanent location for the boxing program. The good news is this gets it open before the start of summer.
Ms. Doyle?
Great news. Glad to hear it. Daryl, thank you. Wonderful. One place to be very, very happy. Thank you.
I am so excited. I know you can't see it behind my mask, but this is a win for the city. This is a win for the citizens. This is a win for the youth in Norfolk. So thank you so much to you and your team and the rest of the administration for making this effort and creating this reality for our communities.
Thank you. Ms. Johnson?
Thank you, Mr. Cruz. You worked hard with this boxing rink and for the children, and that it will serve the entire city of Norfolk. It just so happens to be in Park Place, but I think that all citizens understand it's for all children throughout the entire city. So thank you so very much.
Thank you.
And Team Park Place.
Mr. Spiegel.
I'm good, thanks.
All right, Dr. Feiler. Thank you, Daryl.
You're welcome, sir.
Thank you, Daryl.
Mm-hmm.
All right, with that, Mayor, I'd like to move into the formal presentation by our team that's here on the Norfolk Coastal Storm Risk Management. This is the update to the flood barrier system that's going to extend through downtown, east along the Elizabeth River waterfront into Waterside, and ultimately, or east towards Harbor Park and west towards Waterside and towards Nauticus. This is what we've been essentially referring to as phase one of the project. Make something that's been very confusing, I think, to the public. Every chance we've had, we've tried to reiterate. This coastal storm risk management project is the entire city almost, right? So this includes all of this downtown flood barrier project. There's a Lafayette surge barrier for the Lafayette River. There's also a project at Pretty Lake. These all have then phases inside each of those kind of bigger projects. So what we're going to talk about this evening is where we are in the process for construction of phase one of this downtown portion. And that is about a 600 and some million dollar project, of which, you know, we've had conversations at our retreat and at other moments about what our match is for that. But we are now at a point where I think we can start showing pictures and talking about what the protection looks like, how it's going to look along the riverfront. I really want to thank Colonel Hallberg for being here. Colonel Hallberg is the district commander here in Norfolk for the Army Corps of Engineers. He has his folks from his team here as well. I know at least one of them. I don't think I have everybody on here, Colonel. Maybe you can introduce everybody else. But I know Aaron's here, Aaron Edmondson, who's one of the chief designers with the Army Corps. We're going to walk you through this a little bit, talk about some of the intricacies of this project. As you can imagine, this is a big project, and there's certain areas that are a little bit more challenging than others. We'll talk through that, and then obviously, I think, Colonel, are you comfortable taking questions as they come? Hold them to the end. Really, your call. Okay, Mayor, we can take some questions as council members may have questions as we go through the presentation. So with that, Colonel, thanks for being here this evening, and take it off whenever you're ready.
All right. Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council, thank you for inviting us here today so we can really describe the how and the what behind the Norfolk Coastal Storm Risk Management System. We all understand why. It's about protecting the city against coastal storms. Not going to do much for, you know, rainy days like today on the interior, but it's protecting against sea level rise and those coastal storms. I do want to talk a minute about partnership, because I really value the partnership we have with the city. And partnership is, you know, it's founded on, you know, the basis of the three C's: communication, commitment, and collaboration. And I think we have great and open communication with the city as we go through this design, that there's commitment from both sides to get to really a collaborative design, making sure we have the needs of the city, and it's just one plan that's working together. So the team's going to come up and describe the how together, you know, with Kyle as part of that team, and describe to you what. So what is in that phase one? What does it look like to help protect the city? So I will, we got Kevin here. He's our architect, and he's gonna show you some of the great architectural features with a flyby. And we have Aaron, who's the design branch chief, and Michelle Hamer. She's our planning chief for the city of Norfolk. All right, without any further ado, I turn it over.
Thanks. Yeah, good evening, Mayor, members of council. It's my pleasure to kick off this presentation for you tonight. I'm going to start out at the higher level, 30,000-foot view, and we'll start to drill down into the details of phase one with renderings. And as the Colonel mentioned, we've got a fly-through that we will live here tonight walk you through so we can spin it around and hone in on areas of interest as you all see them. So again, just to reiterate the why, this is the future of the city of Norfolk without the project. And this is something none of us want to see, obviously. So we're talking about protecting the city against the level of coastal storm that could happen every year. There's a 1.4% chance every year that this storm could happen. It's the design life, if you will, is out to 2075. So not quite what you think of as a 100-year flood. Just to clarify, the FEMA 100-year flood maps that we're used to talking about and the modeling and the water levels that go into that mapping are slightly different than what the Army Corps of Engineers base their design off of. Their design is more stringent and at a higher level of protection. So with the project, this is what we're accomplishing. You can see most of the city is dry under this scenario. Of course, the Navy base, as part of the Civil Works dollars, were not allowed to be evaluated as part of this project, but we are working closely with the Navy on their efforts in coordinating together with them and how that relates to these projects. You'll notice Lake Whitehurst doesn't have any protection measures, but it's the weir box or the dam there, Lake Whitehurst, is high enough under the analysis to not need any measures taking place. Keep in mind, we've already kind of started the project in a way. This map doesn't sort of reflect it necessarily, but the Ohio Creek project is in its last year of construction. It's really part of the whole system. The key here is, again, to build the citywide system. And for instance, we're not nourishing the beach anymore as well. So that project was actually authorized and funded a few years ago. We reevaluated that as part of this study and found that there wasn't a need to provide more nourishment or more protection than what was already done back in 2016 and 17. And so we've, through the process of the feasibility study, we've gone through and prioritized the different areas of the city. As you develop these types of projects, you break the city out into watersheds. And so we've got separable elements, we call them, where each dark line shown on the map represents a structural measure, like a flood wall or a flood gate at the mouth of the Lafayette River, for example. And so each of those provides a level of protection behind them. And those are color-coded to match sort of the structural darker color. The light color is to coincide with what is being protected. So everything in the light blue is what's protected by the surge barrier. So that's about a third, if not more, of the city's land area protected by that one measure. And as part of this project, you know, we are starting in area one, the red line. We'll drill into phase one. Aaron's going to get up here and talk you through how we are phasing that design and construction planning out as well as the renderings. But just to point out, after we've kind of completed one or gotten, you know, all the designs started at least in one, we will begin to start designing in area two, which would be the Pretty Lake water body floodgate. And really, I'll show you a timeline here in a second that sort of shows how these all kind of sequentially start to fall in line together. And again, Ohio Creek is white on here because we've already built that protection essentially. And then we're doing, there's other areas of the city where we're doing what's called non-structural. These are things like basement filling, house raising, flood proofing, and occasionally it may be a buyout. But what we're kind of setting those projects aside into their own projects. So they're so complicated, they're so nuanced, that we've got a complete separate working team from the design of the flood wall and the flood barrier system. It's going to be a completely kind of separate effort to work through those issues. And we just had our first kickoff workshop with the Corps today to start working through some of the lessons learned we've done through the FEMA projects, the house raising projects we've done, as well as lessons learned from the other Corps districts that have done some of these at this type of scale. And so everywhere you see the hatch on the match, those are areas where non-structural is recommended in the plan. And so looking at about a 10-year timeline, that's the goal here of this project, is to complete from today all of these measures, all these structural measures and the non-structural measures within about a 10-year time frame. And as Dr. Filer mentioned, we've gotten $400 million from the federal government to start this process. To unlock all of that $400 million, the city or the non-federal sponsor, we are looking to get help from the Commonwealth and the state on this, would need to come up with $215 million. And that's, again, just the start. The entire citywide plan is, it's today's dollars, we've refreshed all the numbers, is $1.8 billion. So we've got lots of work to do there on the financing plan, and we're working closely with all of the team members and consultants that the city has to do that as well, like I said, trying to get the state on board. But when you look at that $400 million plus the $215, based on the level of design we're at now, about 10%, we feel like we can get through all the areas up into the existing downtown flood wall. So the downtown flood wall protects the city quite a bit already. It's not the same level that we're building to under this project, but since it is providing protection now, we would like to leave it in place as long as possible, basically, and come back to it at the end. So you can see that the downtown, and if you can see my mouse, that is the grayed out kind of grayed out color boxes here in gray boxes. Those represent things that we don't think we've got enough funding to do. Where you see a color-coded box, again, it matches the match down the colors on the map down here. And the colored part means it's design efforts. The gray would be construction efforts. Okay, and so to get to get all of these parts done, another reason why we're timing these the way we are is we're trying to keep in mind sale 250 in 2026. We don't want to tear up Town Point Park and all of downtown during the middle of that very special event. So we're sort of staggering things in a way to time it with that event in the downtown area. But you can see we would begin some of these design efforts while we're in construction and design and other areas. But then at the bottom here, you can see we've got some money called out for what we're thinking about piloting different scenarios of the non-structural. So we know we're going to fill some basements. We know we're going to raise some houses. So we want to do that in a couple different places, a couple different scenarios to kind of get some more lessons learned, figure out all the different things that we'll run into as we move around the city. So we're going to look at finding typical examples in certain neighborhoods and certain types of projects to get those started as early as we can. And then we'll work through the rest of the non-structural measures around the city. So that's the overall plan and timeline. And again, this is the colored ones up here, and this part down here is what we think the $615 million will get us as of right now, based on what we've got. So from there, I'm going to hand it over to Aaron Evanson. Aaron is the chief. Yes, sir. Go ahead. I can hop back. Yeah.
Maybe Aaron's going to hit this. Can you go back to your very first map? I want to look at the non-structural plan. So Berkeley, Campostella are considered non-structured mitigation measures, and that's going to be fielding basements, that's going to be buyouts if you determine, and raising homes. And that work is planned to be concurrent.
That's right. Yeah.
With all the other structural measures.
Any engagement, any outreach with the communities of Berkeley and Campostella already? Have you had any?
Not on this topic. That's what we workshopped
today to start that planning and process of how we do that. Yeah, it's you know, we've learned a lot from the FEMA. It's obviously very sensitive to the residents, the homeowners, the tenants, all those different scenarios. We want to get some examples to play that through all the way from beginning to end and make sure we've got it all squared away. So we haven't started that public campaign on that aspect of the project. And really, this is our first kickoff of even a lot of these structural elements. We've shown the maps, but tonight we're going to show those renderings. And again, this will allow us then from here to take it to the public. So,
sure. Direction that first map, because I want to see, without the protection. So without the protection, Berkeley Campostella, it's at the bottom, it's at the very bottom, okay. And I see where, without the protection, Berkeley is pushed to Portsmouth almost. And with the protection, let's see what it looks like. All right.
Oh, sorry, I skipped it. Yeah. So it'll still show the inundation going into the neighborhood.
That's right.
Right.
Basements, raising homes and buyouts, because there's no structure mitigation, it's only non-structure mitigation. I think that we need to be very open and very clear.
Yeah.
That's the policy. That's the direction that we want to go in. I think that's a conversation that we need to have at this council level if there's not going to be any structural protection for this outside. So we're going to be filling basements, raising homes, and buyouts in the Hardy Field section. Primarily, the Hardy Field section is where the inundation is, as well as in Campostella. So I just want to make sure that we just don't gloss over that, because that is serious.
Yeah, and I think that
area, to be honest, is an area that our office has looked at to even approach with maybe a different type of agency like HUD to go in and do like an NDRC type of project that's not maybe separate from the core project, but it could provide the same level of protection. We're challenged down there by all the shipyards and industrial facilities on the waterfront. But I think everything gets kind of reevaluated here in the early stages, especially with the new administration in the White House. There's a big emphasis on environmental justice and I think this is an area where we need to take a harder look at that and like you said, come in with full transparency and openness to that community when we get there. It's definitely top of mind for us in our office. So.
Yeah. I don't know what storm it was, but Ingleside, which would be a part of Broad Creek, it was very damaging to that particular portion of the community. People, I guess, I don't know how many people lost their automobiles, but it really flooded over there. Put the map up, I guess you say, where Ingleside would be a part of Broad Creek, which is that number one or
number four right here?
Four, so.
Yeah.
It'd be this barrier.
Okay. And that will be a physical barrier?
Yeah, this dark green line would create a surge barrier in the Broad Creek river body that would be closed ahead of a big storm. There are neighborhoods on sort of on the outside of that would get non-structural.
Those are hatched here on this map. So I don't know the name of those off the top of my head, but it could be some of the areas you're talking about. Mm-hmm.
Yes, I was to piggyback off of what Councilman Riddick was saying, because in the small print right there, you have Ingleside listed, and it's non-structural. So that will also be concurrent. And also, just to be very clear, Ingleside is included in the Broad Creek surge barrier, or is it just non-structural measures?
I believe
Ingleside, the neighborhood, is right here, south
of
the barrier.
Of the barrier,
I think it's on the south of the barrier.
That's
so
why it's getting non-structural.
So it'd be non-structural.
north of 264 would be protected behind the barrier.
Yeah, right. So the barrier is going to basically align with the bridge at 264.
So anything south of that, between that and the river, Elizabeth River, would be non-structural.
Okay, Ms. Johnson.
I just have a question about the flood wall, the flood barrier, and non-structural. So when you discuss the Lafayette, Area 3, Lafayette, yes. So along the Lafayette, I have Lindenwood, Villa Heights. There are several communities, such as Green Hill Farms, Ingleside, Lindenwood, Villa Heights, and a few other communities. And so my question is, when will we as a city get to the community side of things? You know, I've been discussing Lafayette, the Lafayette part of the river, because we have the park, we have the cemetery, we have Villa Heights, we have Lindenwood, and then we have Calvary Cemetery. All of that is along the Lafayette
river. Yeah.
Yes, the Lafayette River, as well as visiting Ingleside and Campostella, taking a trip out there, and to actually see the water rising, similar to Green Hill Farms, where the water is rising and there is no protection between the water and the people's backyard. So it's literally, at least with Ingleside, they have a mixture of barriers there. They have wood, they have stone.
Okay.
So there's a couple of man-made barriers there. But once you get to Green Hill Farms, there is nothing there. The water literally, when it rises, washes up to their back door, similar to what the mayor was addressing, a complete washout. So when we're talking about the Lafayette Area 4 along that Lafayette River, there's a lot of work being done on equal justice along the waterway. So I'm very interested in hearing more about the Lafayette and the Broad Creek areas.
Okay.
And the barrier, correct, and the non-barrier, what was that?
Non-structural.
Non-structural, yes.
Okay.
So that's more information that I would like to know.
Okay, sure.
Thank you.
Yeah, it brings up a good point. I mean, something to keep in mind is that this project is a tidal flooding project, right? And so there's all kinds of other things, right? We've got water quality issues. We've got the stuff Councilwoman Johnson and Councilwoman Doyle have brought up about, you know, enhancing the waterfront appearance in Villa Heights and things like that. So those are all additional issues. I think what Kyle alluded to, and this is something that's important, and we'll have to just keep working on this. This is the piece that the Corps is allowed to do, is supposed to do, and we got the money to do. However, there are a bunch of other things that we can do through other agencies. And so I think it's really important, and Colonel Hallberg is big on communication, and he and I have talked a lot about, you know, joint communication, making sure people understand. I mean, this is an amazing project. It is vital for the city. We didn't think we'd get it this fast. We're getting it a lot sooner than we thought. But this doesn't take care of everything. This doesn't take care of heavy rain events. This doesn't take care of water quality issues. This, you know, we have all of those things we also are going to need to think about, and those may take and require other sources of funding, including our own capital projects. You know, we may have to just build pump stations in spots because we just need pump stations, right? So it's a good point, Councilwoman Johnson. I think while this is exciting and it's kicking off what will be ultimately the protection of this city for the next, Colonel, what do we think, 100 years?
150?
At least 50. All right, so at least 50. You know, it does not address everything. So we will absolutely work with every council member in their particular areas as these projects start getting to those areas.
Do we know what impact this will have on preventing the rivers and bay from backing up and causing flooding? Will this allow stormwater drainage? You know what I'm talking about is our primary street flooding. It is, a lot of it is from major storm events coming out of the river. Will this prevent it from coming out of the river and abate that rain flooding that we have?
Well, the barriers would be closed ahead of those big storms that typically cause that. So, yes.
Yes.
But we may not close them for every tidal departure that's kind of above a normal high tide, right? So there's a threshold at some point where it makes sense, you know, it's the cost and maintenance of operating these things every time there's a little bit of a high tide is probably not tenable. So we would have to find that threshold, and that would be the point we activate the system. I think it's probably fair to say, yeah.
Yeah, like you get a king high tide, an astronomical high tide, get nor'easter, you know, all last week it makes sense to raise the gates then to protect the backfield.
Okay. All right, who's next?
All right, yeah, so we'll hop
into a little more deep dive of phase one. And show the model. I'm gonna stand here if that's okay. Yeah, Mr. Mayor, council members, thanks for having us today. Again, I'm Aaron Edmondson. I'm the chief of design branch for the Corps of Engineers here in Norfolk District.
I'm trying to talk fast, but I am an engineer, so I'm trying not to get too complicated here. But if you have questions, let me know. So what I'm going to talk about today is phase one, and then we've broken that down into two phases, phase 1A and phase 1B. Phase 1B encompasses Town Point Park and Waterside, as you know it today, and then transitions just past Berkeley Bridge. And then phase 1A picks up right at Berkeley Bridge and runs past Harbor Park, past the substation, across Newton's Creek and the railroad line, and then over and ties into the high ground at Campostello. Again, Kyle mentioned earlier, we met through a series of design charrettes over the past year on each one of the areas that show on the map here, from Town Point Park, Waterside, Berkeley Bridge, and to include the Campostello area around the substation, along with the city and their AEs and my in-house design engineers. So we are designing this in-house with Norfolk District personnel right now, solely. We focused on 1A because we wanted to stay away from that Sail 250 event, and there's a little more complex in that area in front of Waterside with the real estate that we have there and the confined space. And 1A gave us more of an opportunity to start something very soon that Cal showed you on the schedule earlier in our fiscal year 24, so in about a year. So before today, we've mainly shown these maps with lines on. Those lines don't tell you very much on what that looks like today. So some of the concepts you're going to see, next slide here, is we're going to talk about right now the existing flood wall that's downtown right now is what we call an eye wall. It's basically a concrete stem with a sheet pile below it, below grade, to keep that water out. There's a lot of issues with that in the inventory around the country today. We saw a lot of those issues come to life in Hurricane Katrina, with overtopping and a lot of failure in those wall sections. So we look to replace those, especially if you get over 6 feet tall in urban areas, with what we call a T-wall. So if you're not familiar with that, it's basically a concrete foundation with a concrete stem wall, and then below the ground, like an iceberg, is where most of the work is where you have steel or concrete piles for the foundation. With the T-wall, there's battered piles, so they're at an angle, both on the land side and the riverside, and then there's a sheet pile wall in the middle to keep seepage out. What we're also going to build with Norfolk CSRM is what we call a bend wall. Basically, it's a concrete box, three-sided, with the top on it and filled with material. It's a gravity wall to provide that protection. The protection comes from a small parapet wall on the land side, and then you have foundation piles below that. The advantage of this one over a T-wall is that there's only one batter pile towards the water side, not towards the land side. And I'll talk about a little bit of that more in a minute. And then we also have a levee. So the Corps of Engineers likes a levee. I think everybody's familiar with a levee. It's an earthen levee with grass on it. We all like grass. It provides us a lot of protection, but it takes a lot of real estate. So we can't put that everywhere because you're, I think you're over 99% urbanized here in Norfolk. So we have to go with options such as a T-wall or a bin wall. So we wanted, Kevin's gonna fly the model and be the pilot today, and what we created based off of our 10% design that we have so far, we're looking to be about 35% at the end of the summer. We created this concept. What you're looking at right here is Town Point Park and a levee section that we're proposing to build, or we're designing to build, that's located right here. Top of protection, as you can see on an elevation marker, is at 16.5 feet NAVD 88. Now, we don't have a 16.5-foot high levee or a flood wall. It depends on what the ground level is adjacent to that. So at Town Point Park, you're about 8 feet. So you have an 8.5-foot high levee section. When we did the design charrette, the reason we like the levee section here, we had the real estate, first of all, but second of all, it provides that green space that you can incorporate into the concert area and the festival like you had last weekend. And then people can walk over that and access that. You can sit on that and have a picnic and really enjoy the surroundings. There's also a maintenance trail on the top, what we call a maintenance trail, that we need. We need to inspect the flood system after it's constructed, along with the city. You can't walk the whole thing, so we have to drive on it. But that maintenance trail will be open to the public, and consequently will be also the Elizabeth River Trail as well. So that's another thing we've incorporated into the design throughout the entire flood system, and you'll see that today. So as we move down and we end the levee section just to the side of the auto berth area, you're gonna see gates here. These are sliding gates, or there'll be swing gates. So there'll be, I think you already see some of those in the existing flood wall downtown. They'll be shut before a storm would come in, and then open, you know, 99% of the time when a storm's not here. What that allows you to do is have that view shed, have that access. You can still see the river and still capitalize on that water view that's down there and access to that. We continue down towards waterside with that T-wall structure that we talked about earlier around Fountain Park. What we have here is a large crate box right now. Apologize for that, but it is a concept design, and that's for a pump station. So that's right there. That's modeled off the current pump station that's downtown right now with the existing flood wall. Once we get the capacities that we need to know, we'll finalize the design on that one, but it will be smaller than the one you have shown here today. You can see access gates around Fountain Park. These provide egress and ingress to the park during an event, both for, you know, vehicle access, pedestrian access, and also in, use it in an emergency as well if you had an event down there and need to get out. This is a concept. We've added a couple of extra gates based on some comments, and, you know, that's where we are today. So we moved down from the T-wall over to in front of waterside, and we start to transition in what's called a bin wall, which I talked a little bit about earlier. So one of the things we considered is, why don't we continue with a T-wall along here, right? Ideally, that would be probably the cheapest solution. However, it has the batter pile shown both on the land side and the water side. Well, what we found after we looked for the as-builts of waterside, Dominion Tower, the Sheridan, they weren't very accurate. And we can't accurately locate the foundations for those buildings. So with that, if you remember that angle pile going back into those buildings, we don't want to drive a pile through their foundation. That wouldn't be good. So this bin wall that you're seeing on the sketch today allows us to get in a more narrow real estate area, allows access on the top for pedestrians, both vehicular and walking, biking, and the Elizabeth River Trail. And we're able to do something else as well. So you can see the existing cross-section here of water side as it is today. Elevation of the finished elevation of water slide is about 11.5 feet. If you're sitting at the cafe there having a beer or a coffee and you're looking out over the water, what we can do is put that bin wall in and backfill behind the bin wall and provide that lateral resistance for the flood protection. Yet you have that ease of transition and you keep your view shed, and it allows for the plaza to be maintained in front of waterside. So what you can see here, the line of protection is that parapet wall that's spoken up here and these little concrete walls. We're at elevation 12. If you're standing on the plaza, that will be reconstructed. And then the top of that wall is 16.5 feet. So you go from like a 10.5-foot high wall to only 4.5 feet in front of waterside. And then you minimize the openings as well, the height of them, but then we've also increased the width of them. And then before a storm, what will be put in there is stop logs instead of having gates that you have to operate. And then it allows you to have that view shed from the restaurants to the water and still utilize that space as it's intended to.
Yeah.
So then coming down from Waterside over to the Sheridan, we start transitioning down. We can do that with the bend wall. So we're at elevation 12.5 feet, and then the Sheridan's actually at 9.5 feet. It's a little bit lower than everything else. So for that emergency egress, we can come in and out of the hotel, and we're able to bring that bend wall down in a ramp and allow that access for the trail. A couple more openings with those stop logs that we talked about as well. And then you can keep coming down the walkway. At Dominion Tower here, I think you have an amphitheater that kind of comes into the water. We're going to put a pump station there. It is a low point. Water likes to flow downhill, so we want to capitalize on that for the efficiency of our pump station. We'll replace that amphitheater with an amphitheater with stair steps. Kevin can turn around there and face the water there. So you're at elevation 8, and then when you turn back and look at elevation 16.5 with the top of that parapet wall again, you can see how we're proposing to put in a terraced structure with grass. So you could have venues there or concerts if the city wanted to. And still utilize that space with the pump station. But these access ways do allow us to provide access to the pump station to replace the equipment that's in there and the pumps. We'll continue down the way towards Berkeley Bridge with that bend wall concept that we talked about earlier. And then Kevin, if you could go a little higher over the bridge, looking down. Sometimes I get seasick when Kevin's doing this. So we're going to come down here with the bend wall. There is a railing that you see on the water side of that bend wall. That's a 54-inch high railing that's to meet code, provide fall protection. We're going to zigzag in between the piles underneath Berkeley Bridge. We're coordinating with VDOT right now, and we'll do vibration monitoring and make sure we don't damage the bridge during installation of the flood protection system. And then we're going to transition from elevation 12. We're going to ramp up to elevation 16.5 to a levee section. This will be the first constructible feature that you'll see us start with, and this is the beginning of phase 1A right here with this levee section. So on this levee section, you see it has riprap on the water side. On the land side, it's adjacent to Water Street. It's about 11.5 feet high with the existing grade of 5 feet on the land side. This grassy area doesn't show it too well, but we're proposing, or we will be putting in a natural nature-based feature, a living shoreline. We'll go there as well. And then moving down with the levee section on into Harbor Park, we have the ferry landing that's out there. And next to the ferry landing, we'll have a pump station as well that we put in there with, and then we'll transition into a T-wall in front of Harbor Park, where we'll tie into the casino parcel line of protection. And then we'll cross Newton's Creek, where we'll have the largest pump station, because Newton's Creek is the largest watershed in downtown in Norfolk, actually. And then we'll continue on with that T-wall around the substation and tie into Campostella. We don't have quite renderings for that area yet, so sorry I can't fly you through that area yet, but we're getting there. So besides a line on a map, we can kind of give you some visualizations of what you and the public can see, of what our intent is, and hope that helps. We are working closely with the casino and the city to make sure the protection that I talked about earlier is integrated with their project as well. We're working to get the design reviews done with them. They're actually doing the design with their AE firm, and the design reviews will be done by the Corps of Engineers in a multi-tiered structure, and we'll be helping out with the oversight of the construction as well. But the goal is to have an integrated flood protection system with the casino, and they've partnered with us on that. And then Kyle's going to talk a little bit more about how the trail is integrated into that.
Yeah, well, I mean, I just wanted to mention
we are working with the developer to integrate the Elizabeth River Trail through their site. It'll essentially be the maintenance path of the flood protection that Aaron talked about in other areas. The casino folks were proposing a trail through there, so on top of their berm, we call it a levee in the core world, but it will sit on top of that, and then it'll be part of almost like it'll be part of the flood protection system as it kind of comes through the back of the property where the building is. And we actually have that rendering in here. The flood protection system is these little concrete stems that are sticking up. They're going to have two different types of deployables, ones that are sitting in the ground that pop up, and the parts that are kind of facing the building. And then back here, where they don't have as much activity, there'll be more of the deployable ones that will be brought out. We call them stop logs, but they're sort of sheets that get slid into slots on top of each other. And then just to sort of wrap up, as I mentioned, we are working out the final touches of our communications plan with the Corps. We're excited to let you know today we are launching a website. So a lot of these renderings you're seeing today in the fly-through are published now on this website. And we've got the link here, and it can be made available. But it is live, and it'll be constantly updated, obviously, as this project progresses. And then just on the city's effort side, I just want to, you know, reiterate that we are, our office is working closely with Public Works, Communications, kind of all departments really to make this happen. And we're putting together consultants to help us with this. We're bringing on some of the city consultants to, you know, do a lot of meetings and help with design efforts wherever they're needed. Real estate is a big aspect of this project, and so we're getting consultants to help us work through those parts as well. And then ultimately, we plan to put out a large RFP for a programmatic management contract for sort of the city side of all the efforts. As you can kind of tell from the Corps, there's lots of disciplines, lots of folks involved on their side, and so to kind of keep up and keep track of everything. As far as our part goes, we're going to bring in a large consultant contract to help with that. So I think with that, we can take on more questions if you have them about the renderings or anything else you'd like to ask about.
Can you go back to the picture or the rendering in front of Town Point Park? And I want to know if I'm in a car, I'm driving on Woodside Drive.
Yes.
Okay. So, yeah, so I'm driving. So yeah, I wanted that view. So that's what I will see if I'm in the car.
Yes, sir.
So, all right. I'll see a barn.
Yes, sir. You'll see a grass and levee.
Originally, it was actually a wall there. But through
wall.
The charrette, we worked out how to green that up.
Trying to maximize the green space.
Right. So if, let's go back. So what if we took that green space and extended all the way to the Town Point Club, and you create this massive park, like Central Park?
Well, we can talk about that with Kyle for sure. Yes, sir. I mean, but right now, I mean, that's our minimum line of protection that we would provide. If you wanted to do that, I mean, that could be what we call a betterment. We'd have to backfill the entire road up on that, or move that levee onto Waterside Drive towards the Town Point Club.
All the Town Point, and you can create a big,
yes sir,
open space, green space.
Yeah,
yes sir, that is a possibility.
Activate that space. And Dr. Fowler's going to figure out the traffic.
So council knows, we have had this conversation about what it looks like at Town Point. Obviously, we were pretty clear early on having something on the outside of Town Point, big walls, that wasn't going to work, right?
And the beauty of Waterside Drive now, go back. So the beauty of Waterside, you have the view. The beauty of Waterside Drive, it's a spectacular view, but that view is gone.
Practically shut it down anyway.
It is. It's heavily utilized there. We did close Bush Street from two lanes down to one, so, and I think that was an attempt to traffic calm a little bit for the cut-throughs that come off the interstate.
But I think if
council would like us to explore this, I think we have
so
an
what,
opportunity.
You know, what I'm getting at, if we're gonna do this, we have the opportunity to create a very nice park.
Yeah.
A waterfront community, a waterfront park, if we're gonna go down this road. So building the levee, the berm, we have not, yes, we're protecting downtown, but at the same time, we have an opportunity to create a great park, a great waterfront park. The cost, what that looks like, if we move that. And, you know, I guess at Main Street, you would have to create a roundabout at Main, and then create another roundabout, a Decker, a roundabout, a radius, and create this massive park for the festivals and concerts that we want. But yeah, that's because the view is gone, so it's just gonna, this is gonna, it's just a thought.
You would also need to look at egress in and out of the city for instance as well, if you're gonna get rid of the road. It's not really under our.
Right. Yeah, we have a lot of traffic stuff. Yeah, I can get with Pat and we'll at least take a look at this and see what we can do. I mean, as it is, when we went from 2-to-1 lane on Bush Street, the intention was to change behaviors a little bit coming off the interstate to make a right onto St. Paul's and towards Brambleton and then use that, you know, to get west in the city. I think we've been moderately successful with that. Obviously, we need a big behavioral change if we took Waterside Drive offline.
I think the bigger picture again, creating a great open space.
Yeah.
We don't have a massive green space, open space downtown. This gives us an opportunity to do several things. One, protect downtown with the football. But more importantly, we have thousands of new residents now living downtown that 10 years ago, where do they recreate? Where's their green space? Where's their park? Where's the park for the people who live downtown? We don't have them. Yes, Mr.
I like the idea. I think that's fabulous. Then you can raise it a bit so that you'll have view to the water for those who are on the green space. I just think as long as we really look at this through the aesthetic eye, we've got to keep our waterfront as beautiful as possible. So building walls, and I know you've added more areas where you can do gates, but you know what? It's got to look attractive. We cannot lose the beauty of our waterfront downtown, or frankly, anywhere in the city. So I'm going to say that with all phases. Communication, I can't stress enough. I really can't. It's so important for people to understand and to have input. And I would say to those who are non-federal funded friends of ours, we need help with a 35% match on all of these projects, not just phase one and phase two and three, all of them. So as we talk to our state delegation, to our governor and to others, we really need to have them build in these project costs so that we're not the ones carrying the cost. I know we're funding the $70 million over the next two fiscal years, I get it, but that's certainly not gonna get us to where we need to be. So I really stress the importance of us lobbying heavily for friends to give us some money that are non-federal funded. But Kenny, Mayor, I like the idea of really looking into that concept and making it as green as possible. Because you're right, I do hear from folks downtown, there really isn't a place to go play. We have a few playgrounds here and there, but not huge open space.
Most big cities, major cities have a park, I mean a great central park or place. All right, let's go around the table real quickly because they're here for questions. So thank you for your presentation, Colonel. Team, thank you very much. Great presentation. Mr. Riddick, let's go around the table.
Yeah. You kept mentioning parapet. Is that a material?
Oh, no, sir. That's the short side of the concrete wall on the bin wall that I was showing you that Kevin's zooming in on right now. That little,
right.
I'll call it stub up of the
parapet wall.
Okay. That's it. All right. Thank you.
I don't believe you've designed any surge barriers yet, but I get a lot of questions. Can you describe a generic surge barrier, what people could expect in the future?
Yeah, so at Lafayette, and we were only at a very, very minimal design that was included in the feasibility study. So Lafayette is what we call a surge barrier. You can look a similar one up in INC02 in New Orleans, was one that I was involved with where we built that. Basically, it's a combination wall of sheet pile and concrete, the concrete top on it, and it has gates located within that barrier to allow tidal flow in and out. I think we have 9 tidal gates or lift gates in there and one large sector gate that will allow, you know, navigational traffic for large vessels, I think up to 150 feet wide right now. So it's a large concrete wall structure spanning across open water with gates intermixed in there.
We had
anticipate the need for locks or just gates?
Just gates for tidal flow. Locks are intended to raise the water up and down as you progress through a, you know, a series of higher and lower water levels, which is not the case here. So our main concern is that tidal flow, keeping that fresh water in and out and don't get stacked.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Okay, Ms. Royster.
The without project, that slide, if you could go to that. Did that slide include, I guess, was the Ohio Creek watershed project that we're currently doing? Was that reflecting it already being completed, or?
No, no, that this map is from our feasibility study. It predated the watershed, the Ohio Creek watershed project.
All right, so the next one shows it. But
no, these maps are also from that feasibility study. So we're gonna, you can see it's like from 2016 there on the map, so it just hasn't been updated.
Okay.
To show that, but
I was curious when I saw that, because I was like, are we working on that
right
now?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. I caught that.
Go to the next one though. If you go to that other map, it's showing in white. There you go. So that white area there, Councilwoman, is the already protected area.
All right. Thank you. Thank you for the clarity.
Okay. You good, Ms. Preston? Ms.
Yes.
Ms. Johnson.
I'm fine. I just when I look at Town Point Park, that whole area that you're looking at to design and protect us. Even with visiting smaller towns and cities and counties, whatever their waterfront property is, that's the value of the entire city. And somehow, we've already said that there's a possibility that we could do some things not to put up so much structure, the concrete and things like that. Our top priority is to protect our waterfront, our city, but at the same time, it's our jewel. And so right now, if you look at downtown waterfront, we have structures already in place. So somehow we need to connect.
That's a priority for me, as well as protecting the city.
So thank you so very much.
If you
strongly consider that.
Yes, ma'am, we will, and we have, to the greatest
extent
possible.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Mr. Speaker.
Yeah, I appreciate all the work that's going into this. It's been a long time since we had the initial discussions many years ago, and glad to see that, you know, we were selected and can move forward. You know, my concern is going to continue to be, as Courtney was mentioning, the 35%. I don't have a lot of faith in the Virginia General Assembly, and they can't even negotiate a budget.
It's going to be accepted. Give me a pass.
No, the General Assembly has changed since Kenny's been in there. It's a different group of people. You also have quite a few legislators who don't believe in global warming, and they don't believe that we should be funding projects like this. We have a governor who has, some opinions about this, and I'm concerned that, you know, they're going to say things like, well, we're giving you a casino, you need to use the revenue from that to pay for this stuff. And this is a significant project. Norfolk is the economic hub for Hampton Roads. And I hope that there's some very smart delegates and senators out there who understand the need for protecting this, protecting us and the citizens, and that we can't do this on our own, particularly because a large percentage of our land is already not taxable. And, you know, this has long-term implications with the military, and, I just hope that there's, maybe there's a little bit of hope out there. I just don't know if this is the General Assembly to carry this. We'll continue working and lobbying, and I hope they're listening. I don't have faith in them, unfortunately. And I think it's going to take delegates and senators from other localities to actually step in and help us to carry this. So, I know, Kenny, you'll do everything you can. You have very strong connections up there in Richmond and in Washington, you know, hopefully we can, you know, continue pushing it. So we'll have to start early, obviously, with our legislative, you know, process on pushing this.
So if I could,
yes,
Mayor, real quick on that topic.
Sorry, I'm not going to jump off a bridge or anything. I'm just
We are thinking about it a lot at the staff level. I mean, this is a heavy lift. You know, we know for a fact over the next, what are we looking at, 5-6 years, it's about a $215 million lift at the least, right? So, Kyle and I did go to Richmond. We did meet with some of the governor's staff in Richmond. Kyle, do you want to talk a little bit about the money we made a proposal for, why that may not be the right bucket? We didn't get a no on that. We got a, this might be the right bucket, but I think there's a bit of optimism. But.
Yeah, so our office put together a grant application for the Community Flood Preparedness Fund that the state offers, which is funded with the REGI dollars, the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative, which we've heard, you know, the governor has expressed interest in taking Virginia out of. But So we did have, we asked for $28 million in our grant application, which is about half of our first, chunk that we need to put in for this first phase. So like Dr. Fowler said, we met with them. We didn't get a hard no. They're looking into it. There were more applications of funding asked for during this last round than dollars available. Our $28 million is about 75% of the 40 that was available. So we recognize that, and they do too. There's loan programs in that CFPF funding. There may be other resources that the state is working on to help out with these types of projects. It's not clear yet which path is going to work out. I think we will probably, hopefully we'll get something from our grant request. Maybe not the full amount, and I think, you know, what we're trying to do is just start that conversation of how do we get the Commonwealth to come in. We've pointed out that there are quite a few states around the country that cover the entire 35% of the non-federal match on projects like this, that localities don't do it. So we're sort of, doing that level of research as well to kind of find out what models were working around the country pointing those out and presenting those as ideas to our partners up there, and we're continuing to work and try to meet with the folks up there as much as we can, as they're willing to. So,
any other questions for Kyle? Or
it's a great presentation.
Yeah.
Thank you. Really well done.
Great. Thank you, Colonel. It's always good to see you.
Thank you. Great. Thank you, Kyle. Thanks,
Kyle.
The project moves forward, you know, we'll bring Colonel and his staff and Kyle in for work sessions. Communication is really going to be key. This first phase, 1A and 1B, there's not a lot of impact on the residential level. It's mostly commercial stuff and the casino and the ballpark. But as you saw from the map here, these other projects, particularly Councilman Smeagol's project at Pretty Lake, this is going to involve some residential ramifications. These gates are big, they need a lot of space on either side. We will definitely be keeping council up to date and the communities up to date way in advance of whenever any of this construction would get started. Okay. Next, we have Dr. Susan Perry here. It's been a while since we had an update from Dr. Perry on our efforts with People's First and the Tidewater Gardens project. So I want to thank Susan for taking time to come in this evening. Take it over whenever you're ready, Susan.
All right. Good evening, Mayor, Vice Mayor, members of Council, Dr. Filer. Thanks again for having me today to talk to you about our work in St. Paul's and specifically in the Tidewater Gardens area. As usual, there is a lot going on to report, so I'm going to go ahead and get started. We'll start with our most important asset is our people, so I'd like to give you an update on the People First program first. You can see here on the right-hand side is sort of our typical data snapshot that we like to report on sort of our four pillars, right? How are we doing in education, housing, economic mobility, and health and wellness? The first thing I would point out to you, though, is that 597 families have signed up to work with People First. So, again, that's 97% of the families that USI, People First, has gotten their trust and has engaged them into the People First program. So we're really excited about that. But, of course, we are working to move kids into high-quality child care programs and after-school programs. We've got a slew of partners that are working with us in this space. And, of course, we're ramping this up as we get closer to the end of the school year to ensure that our kids, that our youth are engaged in summer programs. We're working to get them engaged in the NEL program. So we've got lots of applications in to that program as well as other citywide programs. You can see here that of the 400 or so able-bodied residents who are able to work, 287 or 71% of them are employed. And as of April, our April average hourly salary is $15 an hour. So that, I think the last time maybe I was before you, that was more around $11.50. So we're slowly seeing that inch up, and then you can see how that equates to the average annual income, again, seeing that grow from at baseline $11,900 now up to $20,225. Still not high enough, but we're seeing that continue. And after, you know, 2.5 years of work, we're seeing that move up, and we'll keep moving that up until we get folks to sort of family-sustaining wages. We are continuing to connect children and adults to health insurance. So we've got all but three of the children in Tidewater Gardens are now connected to health insurance. We're going to get those last three. 90% of the adults are also connected to health insurance. But another really great data point here is that 91% of them are now connected to services to manage a chronic health condition, whereas before we were seeing most people kind of engaging in an emergency room. And so now we've got 91% of the adults have a doctor, a doctor's office, and are visiting that regularly. And then really, as we get closer to the end of the year, doing a lot of work with our juniors and seniors in high school. So you can see we've got 15 high school seniors that in our total population, and all are slated to graduate this year. You can see all of them, just about all of them, have college or career plans after school. Just last Friday, USI held an event where they brought in juniors and seniors and their parents to really talk to them about what their plans were. So we're trying not just to talk to seniors, but reaching down a grade as well to really kind of talk with them about what their plans are, connecting them with the resources. So we're doing college tours. Again, we're connecting folks with the NEL summer work opportunity. We've had folks saying, I'm really interested in going to college. I'd like to see if I could get a scholarship around X. And so our People First staff are going out and connecting them with those resources and tracking those resources down for them. Next slide. Okay, so on relocation, we are about 93 families left in Tidewater Gardens community today. So about 83% have been successfully relocated. And as you can see here, our numbers continue to trend in the same way, about half, a little over half, desiring to return to the community, which is a fantastic number. The majority of them are staying in Norfolk. About half are utilizing vouchers, and that's generally what we have seen in other projects. And again, 85% moving to those neighborhoods with low poverty rates. That is holding strong. Next slide. And so a couple of innovative best practices that we're putting in place to really give us good traction on this People First work, you can also see here. So we've awarded a contract to Norfolk State University to conduct a longitudinal evaluation of the People First program. So we want to always be sure that we are good stewards of taxpayer dollars. We want to make sure that the way that the People First program was designed, that it's being implemented in that way. So that will give us sort of the longitudinal look at some of these outcomes, long-term outcomes that will take a couple of years for families, you know, for us to really be able to see those results for families, but also gives us real-time information that we can tweak policies or procedures or practices that need tweaking now or that will inform how we do this work differently in other neighborhoods in the future. That also gave us an opportunity to hire some residents onto that research team. And so Norfolk State hired on two St. Paul's residents making $19.50 an hour, and they'll be employed again for those 4 years, but also gain some really valuable skills. And then the second one is a landlord incentive program. I know I've mentioned this to you before, but I'm really, really excited about this program. We are working with researchers at Old Dominion University and Dartmouth who really understand what are the best practices around landlord incentives. How can we entice more residents, or excuse me, more landlords in neighborhoods of opportunity to get on board and rent to our residents coming out of Tidewater Gardens. And so we're doing monetary and non-monetary incentives. Obviously around monetary, we're looking at things, or we've implemented things like sign-on bonuses for neighborhoods of opportunity. We are also providing assistance for small maintenance issues that might be required in order to pass the inspection. We are covering the potentially any vacancy that a landlord might experience while they wait for the unit to be inspected. And then we are also doing things that HUD has what they call rent reasonable for the specific area that an apartment might be in, but then the voucher only pays a certain amount of money. So we are providing the difference between what is rent reasonable for that area and what the voucher will cover in order to get families in to neighborhoods of opportunity. Now, we only started doing this since January, but since that time and really in the last couple of months, we have awarded 11 since January, and I just got word that we have 3 more that have come on this month. So we really are seeing more landlords now that they understand the program. We're utilizing the landlord liaison at NRHA, some of the workshops that they're doing along with our neighborhood services department to really lay out this program, help them understand the benefits of renting to our residents. Obviously, it gives them somebody who they can connect with if they're having an issue. So it really is a kind of a win-win for both landlords and our families. Okay, so moving on to housing. As you know, we've broke ground on the first two buildings in Tidewater Gardens. We're calling them 19 and 20 at the moment. More on sort of that naming process here towards the end of this presentation. But those two are under construction now. If you've driven through the community, you're seeing that construction. You're seeing construction from the roadways. The pump station is just about complete. We'll have two more buildings coming online and breaking ground after the first of the year as well. So again, just lots of construction happening in that area. All the more reason why the final successful relocation of those remaining 90 residents is that much more important. On this slide, you'll see how the housing program laid out. So I'm not sure that I've been before you since we settled the lawsuit, but you can see here sort of the little bit of changes in the housing plan here. It's still generally a third mix between subsidized or replacement units, affordable units, and then market rate units in the new development. If you couple that with the 70 offsite units, in total, we'll have 784 new total units, with 330 of them being replacement units dedicated specifically to former residents of Tidewater Gardens, in addition to those 238 which give preference to residents from Tidewater Gardens as well to use their vouchers in. So if you combine the affordable, the replacement, on-site and off-site, we have 568 of the original of the housing units available to the original 618 Tidewater Gardens residents. And of course, this council has already guaranteed their right to return to those Tidewater Gardens residents through the ordinance that you passed last year. You can sort of see on the slide here the outlines. Of course, all of this is in phases. The red are the two buildings that we broke ground on last month. Shortly behind that will be what you see in yellow. And then what you see in green begins again to cross over Church Street, gives you those lower density family style units. I'm going to show you a video of in just one moment of the design of those housing units, and then we're in the final in the designing phases of the final stages there in blue. And so you just see some renderings here again of the type of housing that is being designed. At Councilwoman Royster's urging, encouraging us to tell our story, we did put together a video with the help of WPA that shows sort of how the vision and the reality come together between housing and amenities to create this beautiful neighborhood. We often do a lot of presentations and we tell this story then, but it's only sort of for a captive audience. So we wanted to put it in a video that we could then show far and wide, and we'd like you to get a sneak peek of it first here.
Welcome to a transformed St. Paul's Tidewater Gardens neighborhood. We've been working for the past several years to design a place that feels like home. Let's go on a walking tour. We're headed south on Church Street, the heart of the community. Church Street has been aligned with the steeple of St. Mary's Basilica and the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Memorial. This grounds the neighborhood in a sense of history, pride, and place. We've arrived at a public plaza with public art on the corner of Church and Freemason, and we'll pause here and reapproach the neighborhood from downtown along Freemason Street. These buildings have a color-changing facade that animates the space as you walk by. They directly connect with the residents' desire to have architecture that is fresh, modern, and colorful. The ground floor of each building is filled with commercial and retail space, ready for a mom-and-pop shop, a doctor's office, thriving nonprofit, and more. You'll notice that the sidewalks are wider than Norfolk's standard, and so is the verge. This has been purposefully designed so that families can easily pass each other with strollers, wagons, and wheelchairs, and everyone has space to move side by side. Likewise, the wide verge allows trees to grow and provide plenty of shade to keep people on the sidewalks nice and cool. We're back at that public plaza where there's something for everyone to do, and some good people watching from the rooftop and community space. Now we're moving south along Church Street to the Basilica of St. Mary's. The steeple guides us past retail spaces and live-work lofts. We've placed a coffee shop on the corner, but the kids in Tidewater Gardens have told us they'd prefer ice cream. It's also a great place to gather after church services. We're now taking a turn to head east on Mariner. If you haven't walked down Mariner in a while, you should. It has the most beautiful large trees, and the building and streets have been designed around them. Here, the scale of buildings gets smaller. We heard from families that they wanted a diversity in types and scales of housing, and that's what you'll find in the eastern part of the neighborhood. Manor homes, townhouses, and carriage houses provide options to suit everyone's needs. Large front porches and balconies give families and friends a place to live outdoors and enjoy our beautiful climate. Now we've arrived back at Freemason for your first glimpse of the Blue Greenway. This multi-tiered park both protects the community from future flooding and provides an educational and recreational space lined with a trail. Turning down Chapel Street, you'll again catch a glimpse of the spire of St. Mary's. We'll travel up the street, past the different scales of homes, until we finally arrive at a beautiful neighborhood pocket park. The playground materials have been designed from natural materials, and we've heard from parents how excited they would be to be able to watch their younger kids play safely out the kitchen window while the teenagers head off to play at the Blue Greenway. Circling back up Chapel Street, take a look at the carriage houses. They contain 5-bedroom homes over parking with private terraces for each family. They also help to conceal parking behind the larger apartment buildings on Church Street. Native plantings line the verge, connecting people and the environment. We've arrived at another public plaza, but this one is special. The Blue Greenway turns west and runs under this plaza, culminating at a tree-filled resting place where the water pops back up above ground. The blue building in the background takes cues from the water, shimmering with ground floor public spaces. We're turning down Church Street now, wrapping around the building to get a better sense of the opportunities for mom and pop retail, responding to the residents' needs to live, work, and play in the Tidewater Gardens St. Paul's community. Moving back towards the steeple of St. Mary's, we take one final turn through the Freemason Street Plaza and head back toward the carriage houses. As we fly up above the neighborhood to get a bird's eye view of Chapel Street, Church Street, and the entire neighborhood, we get a view of everything that the neighborhood has to offer. Mixed income housing in a mixed use neighborhood in a place that is transformational for the people who call it home.
So hopefully that gets you excited about what is to come. Our intention with this next is to use this as a way to talk with residents, have them view the video, get their reactions, get their feedback, hopefully incorporate that all into one video. But we will continue, obviously, to take the designs back to the community and get their feedback, especially as we do this last phase of housing. So what you saw in this video is the majority of what's been designed to date, save for that last phase that I pointed out on the previous slide. Okay, so as you know, very important to this work from the beginning is how we're engaging minority and women-owned businesses in the work. So on this next slide, you'll see sort of where we are with that. Council obviously gave us the tools to be able to implement a new procurement policy that sets goals for the project, but also gave us the ability to do some things like sheltered bidding and pulling out smaller contracts to help engage our smaller women and minority-owned contractors. And so far you can see here, this is the work that's been done to date. So we've got the demolition work being conducted by the Housing Authority, and they've had 69% of their work, and you can see the dollar amounts there have gone to minority and women-owned business contractors. For infrastructure phase one, that's the city's work, we've had two contracts so far. The first one was 100% of the award went to a minority firm, and in the second contract, about 27% of that went to women and minority-owned businesses or contractors. And then for People First, which is also funded by the city, we're seeing 66% of their service providers are women and minority-owned contractors. And so housing is next. Obviously, that will be the next report we get give to you. The developer understands the goals of the city, is working very hard to exceed what's already been done, and so we should have a report on sort of what that first phase of those first two blocks looks like from them in the next 2 months. And then finally, in terms of a neighborhood update, obviously I mentioned that the road network is continuing to be built. But we've also been working with residents around what they want to see in the 26-acre resilient park. And so if you go to the next slide, you'll see we did a survey. It was open citywide. We got a lot of great feedback. But when we looked at where folks were living, we realized it wasn't residents of Tidewater Gardens who were responding to the survey. And we really wanted to understand what residents of Tidewater Gardens wanted to see in this resilient park. And so we pivoted, we went back out, we met people where we are, boots on the ground, as Ms. Johnson likes to say. We showed up in all of the spaces that in the neighborhood that we could find residents, and we talked with them, and you see the result here is 148 residents, specifically from Tidewater Gardens, answered the survey for us. And so what you'll see on the next slide is community feedback directly from the residents of Tidewater Gardens of what they want to see in the park. First, you can see we did also ask, are you satisfied with the housing design that you've seen so far? 92% said that they were. But you can see 79% wanted to do hands-on learning things in the park. 71% wanted to be able to cook out with their families. 68% wanted to see spaces for community events or demonstrations. And 65% wanted to see playgrounds. And so we're taking all of this feedback, and that will continue to guide our design process of that of that resilient park as we move forward. But that was really important to us, and we found the need to do that, to kind of pivot in the moment, and Councilwoman Royster has certainly challenged us to make sure that we're talking to the right people, that we're really getting the feedback from the neighborhood. And so as you can see here, again, this is direct feedback from the residents of Tidewater Gardens. And then lastly, just in terms of our next steps, we are rolling out a brand new website here shortly. Again, part of sort of telling our story. We'll have a fresh new look. You'll see that coming in the next month or two. Brinshore is they've conducted focus groups with residents of Tidewater Gardens, with the pastures in the area, with other stakeholders. We've got to stop calling these blocks 19 and 20 or 17 and 18, right? So we really want to begin a naming or branding process for the neighborhood. And so from all of that initial feedback, they have three themes that they will be rolling out in a survey. Again, we'll do the same thing we've done with any of our other surveys and really, you know, boots on the ground to get that feedback. But we'll be coming before you, hopefully, with some names other than Blacks 19 and 20 here very shortly. Of course, the construction and the design is going to continue. And then lastly, the thing I would maybe say about our People First work is you're going to see that shift a little bit, too. As all the residents are relocated off of Tidewater Gardens, we need to think about what that looks like and how, maybe how that changes, right? And so instead of having an office there in Tidewater Gardens, we're looking at, you know, placing all the relocations on a map, understanding sort of where the cluster areas are, and then we'll have staff and People First staff in all of those various areas. So again, we're meeting people where they are. They can easily access those People First resources and staff as they move forward. And with that, I'm happy to take any questions.
Okay, thank you. Questions for Dr. Perry? Ms. Doyle, questions?
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Riddick? Mr. Thomas? Ms. Royster?
Thank you. I talk to you guys every 2 weeks, so.
Yes. Nothing new for you.
Thank you, Councilmember Royster, Mr. Riddick, Dr. Perry, and your team. It's really important that, for me, that I see the transformation of the people from where they start and how they're gradually growing. So that our residents can become self-sustainable. That is really important. That's what it's really all about, to provide them the necessary resources that they need to be successful, but also guiding them through the process, because that is what they're looking for. That is something that our small businesses often talk to us about, to know that the support system is there. And that is exactly what it's going to take for people to be self-sustainable and self-supporting. I made note of the pocket parks. That's big for me. That is something that is found in New Orleans. It's a special place, a gathering place, where people can share and have discussion and experiences. So that was really important to me. And then lastly, you talked about off-site living. When we're talking about the off-site living, my city manager often hears me say about hubs. Creating these hubs throughout the city of Norfolk to meet people where they are, that they don't have to come directly to City Hall, to get the necessary resource, and that's something that Mr. Smiegel and I have talked about over the years for our communities to create these hubs so that people have the access to get what they need at any given time so that the support system is still there. And then one other thing, I saw something called Worth It Wednesday. What is Worth It Wednesday?
So Worth It Wednesday is an engagement and outreach effort by our People First staff. We do it once a month. In the fall, we did Cocoa and Coats, where we just engage residents, have them come out. We had brand new coats for the children and for the adults, but also just an opportunity again to engage with them and connect them to services. We've done a housewarming event in partnership with the Downtown Norfolk Council and with Commune, the restaurant, where people brought items that we are now packaging in housewarming baskets to give to residents who are relocating, right? So that you're not having to take your old broom and your old mop and things of that nature, right, into your new apartment. So we're pushing that out. We'd love to continue to get more donations for that. But it's just our engagement efforts we hold once a month in the community that we'll now have to think about how we do those in those different hubs that you're talking about. But that is our once a month kind of community engagement.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, on one of the first diagrams, you
were still showing Tidewater Park Elementary School. And I know that the school board voted to turn that over to the city eventually. They're going to transition the students. One thing that needs to be added to the design is I really do think we need a crossover on Tidewater Drive from the neighborhood to Ruffner, a raised crossover. And I know that that's tricky because of height restrictions for getting things downtown. That is a major, it is just an unsafe road for that many kids, elementary now, to be crossing. And we have a couple of years to plan it out or get it going, but I really think that that's something that needs to be considered in the budget now. You can't go under, can't do a tunnel because it will flood. Eventually it will over in that area. But we really need to look at doing a raised crossing for that. I mean, you're talking about hundreds of kids that are going to cross that street, and having the with the limited resources with police, and it's just not safe there.
So I will tell you, as part of the planned road
infrastructure, there is a light now that coming out of the neighborhood, crossing over directly into the Ruffner parking lot with a crosswalk and a pedestrian refuge. But I'll certainly go talk to transit about it being raised. But that is, it is planned at least to have that. Yes, sir. Yeah, for sure.
Taking this project on. I know it's a labor of love, and I remember us talking about this at the very, very beginning and putting the application together and getting it into the hands of Dr. Carson. And from that time until to the progress that's being made as it relates to People First, it's the snapshot. It's impressive. 97% of the families being served and the outcomes, as well as the housing mix. When 538 units will be made available to returning residents. It's just so impressive. So thank you for your work.
Thank you.
Dr. Feiler.
So we have the open session. Thank
all
you.
Right.
I move the member of the council to similar form and close meeting 24/2022 at 5:37 p.m. City Hall Building, City of North. Clauses 29 and 3 of subsection A, section 2.2-3711 of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act as amended. Clause 29, discussion the award of public contracts with the Norfolk Tides and in the downtown area where discussion in an open session would adversely affect the negotiating strategy of the public body. Clause 3, discussion of the disposition of publicly held real property in the Military Circle area and Park Place area. where discussion in an open meeting would adversely affect the bargaining position of the public body. Ms. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Mr. Riddick.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigel.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye. We're closed.